confession time. I have never planted a garden.
Yeah, look at that. The garden is lush. So this is obviously future time. Made that video that you were watching about 2 months ago and have been sitting on it because I wanted to see what the garden was gonna do so I could chime in with any sort of tips and whatnot, which I will do. But first, let's let the journey up to this point unfold and then I'll do a little bit of reflective. Probably would have done this or that differently. So, enjoy.
You might be wondering, why plant a garden? Why I could just go to the store, buy fresh veggies, guarantee they're gonna be good every time. Well, you know what? There's nothing much more satisfying than eating the fruits of your labor.
That's actually pretty good. I thought it wasn't gonna be ripe. But I'm gonna keep eating it.
But there are a lot of other benefits you get when planting a garden. Here are 33 good reasons why I suggest you should get your hands dirty in the dirt, plant some gardens, watch some things grow.
My top 33 reasons why you should start a garden. Exercise. You get to soak up the sun. You can save mounds of money. It's a really good conversation starter. Getting dirty with soil is grounding. You get to help save the bees. An overabundance of veggies and fruits makes for great gifts. Getting dirty in the garden and fancy in the kitchen make for a really great date. A garden serves as a great classroom for both learning and teaching. It doesn't get any fresher. Fresh fruits and veggies just taste better. Studies show that keeping a garden going keeps your brain healthy. Gardening is an art that develops an aesthetic sense of creativity. It is known to be a very good treatment for substance abuse. Gardening helps build families and communities. It's a very healthy means of stress relief. It expands your horizons of just life in general. It develops a really good sense of self-sufficiency and also gives you a really good sense of accomplishment. You get to breathe up that fresh plant oxygen. It improves the value of your home. You become more attuned to the weather and your climate. The microorganisms that live in the dirt have been proven to improve your mood. Plus, it beats mowing the lawn. It attracts the hummingbirds and the butterflies. You quickly get to learn how nature works. It helps you expand your palate and try new foods. It just puts you in touch with the world around you. And when you become more attuned to nature, you care for it more. Gardening is reality and truth because it forces you to be aware of what is around you. You notice where the sun is. You see subtle differences in the soil. You have appreciation for that wiggling worm and you acknowledge that he's actually your garden helper. Naturally, you will start to see that awareness spill over into other areas of your life. Each rain and sunshine will have their own special joy to appreciate. And with this awareness and space, you might actually have time to smell roses and smell them. So, that's why I love to garden, or chose to start one. I don't know if I'm gonna love it, I might hate it. But I have a hunch I'm gonna enjoy it, which is why I started.
Today's challenge, plant a garden.
Bring it on.
That looks like fun.
All right, the lasagna gardening is a no-dig, no-till, organic gardening method that results in a rich, fluffy soil with very little work. Essentially, you just add layers of organic material that cook down over time. And today we will put on the very last layer of the lasagna, the cheese. Speaking of lasagna, the lasagna is ready.
I love your camera.
What's that?
I like your camera.
It's
HD, 1080p.
And P2.
And you can flip it around so you can see yourself.
Yep.
Nice. There's a community garden just around this corner, so we're gonna shoot up to it.
Here's a pretty classic example of a garden on a raised bed structure to pour fresh dirt and then put the plants.
The lasagna layering method, however, well, it requires a lot less work, a lot less setup, a lot less maintenance. Here we are. Wrigler Community Gardeners Only. Look at that juicy garden. Based on the layers here, I think they're using a bit of lasagna gardening techniques. So,
why don't we just kind of break down what layers are in my lasagna. Now going backwards on the lasagna garden bed, we have the topsoil, beneath that the hemp fiber, which is just the stalk of the hemp plant. And then beneath that we had some leaves and twigs and kind of just dirt that was already on the property. Beneath that we have the
cardboard. And beneath that we just kind of have just more rough soil, leaves and stuff.
What I've read is
putting that cardboard layer down first prevents the weeds from getting through, and then also provides that very dark, moist place for worms to kind of come up, and they really get the soil going. The more layers, the merrier, starting with probably the more thicker, and then gradually going up until you have your delicious cheese on top. The way to go, in my opinion, or the way that I am going. We will see, I'm new to it. Today's mindful moment comes from our friend the bee. It's the bee meditation.
I am a bee and I buzz. I swoop and I sway. I am happy and I love to fly. I love to make honey. It feels good to my tummy. On my wings, I love to ride the sky. We are billions strong and we play all day long in the flowers under the blue. And we love this earth having given us our birth, and we know that you do too.
Thanks, bee. All right, home sweet home. So this is what we have to work with. We're gonna put the compost on top of this berm, and then we have some more compost in the back
that we will be throwing on top of the garden. Ready? Let's do it.
A little side project. After creating this parking spot, I found myself with a bit of dirt, a berm to do something with. And so this is a very thin lasagna, but we're just gonna like throw wildflowers. So here's what we got. We cleared it out. Just ripped out everything. Here's a little shot of that. Then we threw down a bunch of the IKEA packing material. Here's a little shot of that.
I couldn't hear you from the beginning.
It's a good compost to start the garden.
Wait, you were told that the cardboard was good compost?
It's a good way to...
Then just kind of like raked up the yard a little bit, threw some leaves on there. Here's a little shot of that. Then as we were pouring the hempcrete for the tiny home, here's a little shot of that. We took that remaining material, the hemp lime binder. And then lastly, of course, the topsoil, which is a 50% soil, 50% organic compost that comes from Portland residents. This could actually have come from my kitchen a little bit. So, we are going to now spread the cheese around, and we have ourselves a ripe, fresh, nutritious, garden-ready lasagna bed. Yeah.
Ooh, that's a good-looking lasagna.
You see this little guy here?
That's a tree I ripped out. But an arborist came over, he told me if you drill a hole into the stump of a tree, you can plant like a mushroom spore, and that'll actually eat down into the roots of the tree. For now, we're gonna let the lasagna settle while we figure out what we want to plant.
Ben, teach me how to smile like for a camera shot without looking like a dweeb. It looks fake every time I take a photo. Putting the hay on the top of the soil because it helps the moisture stay in. Being beginning of August in Portland, it is insanely hot. Soil, just from today, even though it's been watered yesterday, it's actually today, super dry because the sun just saps the moisture out of it. Thank you, Scott, for bringing the soap. This hay over, it also has, it's white because it has mushroom in it. That's a straight up mushroom. The white kind of mushroom spores. Just good nutrients for the garden soil, and eventually it'll all just kind of decompose and make it all very rich soil. There is something just absolutely hypnotizing about watering stuff that grows. Watering cameras, not so. We got dinner. Yes, sir. What do we got? Oh, yeah.
There are ants crawling up my pants. Literally. That's the topic for today. How to bring in some homegrown, fresh veg. That's what this book's all about. How to wisdom guide. Right here, the design process. Before we get fancy with seeds, we need to go out, sit down, rather, pen to paper, figure out what is gonna go where. What are your priorities? What do you wanna eat based on that? Come up with a design, and that's what we're doing today. So get out your pen and paper, think about what your goals are, food in the kitchen, start growing your own grub. This is Design Your Garden Challenge.
Okay, so we have our blank slate. First thing we want to do is just plot out the space. If we actually just kind of topsoil and all of that has been laid, pool here, perimeter, big tree here, 3 espalier apple trees that we planted. Little quick shot of that. Here. We have some hops going over here, and that's it for the most part, but here's kind of what we're working with as far as the foundation that we laid yesterday with our lasagna garden bed. Next, designing from the outside in is suggested, but it is a trial and error experience gardening. The only way to really figure it out is to do it. So that's what we're doing. We're doing it. I'm just gonna design this out real quick, and hopefully that'll give you a bit of insight as to how you can get going with your own garden space. Ah, fun tip on getting the plans on paper, use sticky notes. I think that's what I'm gonna do here. This is incredible. You figure out what zone you're in. Based on what zone you're in, when I refer to zone, the US Department of Agriculture plant hardiness zones are determined by the annual frost freeze days and minimum water temperatures. So if you figure out your hardiness zone, Google it, then you just figure out what month you're planting. You pair the two together, your zone, with what month it is, and you can figure out exactly what will flourish. So for me, in Portland, we're in zone, see, 7 or 8, I'm not sure, so I'm gonna look it up. All right, so I just Googled it, and Portland falls within the USDA's hardiness zone 8B. Apparently there are subsections, but 8. That means, well, let's take a look. Here we have August, and we will then go to zone 9/10. Based on this, we can get some snap peas going, some sweet corn, squash, cucumbers, broccoli, kale, cauliflower started indoors, some sow peas, beets, carrots. Taking this information in, based on what zone I'm in and what I would like to plant and what would grow well this time of year in this climate, we kind of created a bit of the gardening layout, which I'm pretty stoked with. Started with what we already have, and then kind of went with what would grow well this season, kind of listed that out, and then circled the similar things like the leafy greens, the root veggies, the taller kind of bushes. And that's a start, and already I feel like this is much more feasible. I can start to visualize what this could be and look like realistically. Now we are going to take this model, this design, and we're gonna go talk to someone who has actually done this. So Mary, just down the street, she is doing a plant sale right now. She has all of these goodies and more. So I'm gonna show her what we have here and see what she recommends and pick up some goodies. free tomato and cucumber starts. Well, that is a good start.
Mary.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm back for some goodies.
Good.
Yes.
Good. You must have got them all planted then.
Planted. I could draw out real quick what I had in mind.
Sure.
And then if you have any suggestions, then I can kind of purchase those key things.
Okay.
To get started.
You need a big piece of paper?
Cool.
That is a cool tripod.
It's so handy.
Okay. I did take a photo of my design here, so this would probably help.
Oh, yeah.
Going with two Asian pear trees, apple pear trees. Gotta get two so they can cross-pollinate. And this one is the mother. Also going with the raspberry tree here. I know, I already have raspberries, but I want more. Also getting some triple crown thornless, thornless blackberries. Here are our herbs. I was looking for thyme and rosemary. So we have what we were looking for and some. Yum. Picking up a salmon berry. I am a berry-aholic. So the which tomatoes were good for the taking?
All of them.
Woo!
Of them.
All of them.
As many as
we want. Oregon Spring. Yes, please. Some peppers. Gonna get some mini bells from this gypsy. Yeah. Last up, some artichoke. And that's what we're going with.
Made the mistake of planting them out along the street.
2, 4, 6, 8, 1 hundo.
Thank you very much.
Oh no, thank you for your help with the plan here.
It's always exciting to plan somebody else's yard.
Well, I should have just hired you to come over. That's true. You just got the knowledge.
I have some knowledge. You know, I don't know of anybody who knows it all. And we all start with nothing. Nobody is born with any gardening knowledge.
That's right. You are the seed to my garden.
Well, good. I hope it grows for you. Yeah. Come back and see us and let us know how it's doing.
Will do.
Mary was a gold mine. That was awesome. I got a lot of the things that I was looking for, from herbs to fruit trees. We got some pear and we got some, a lot of berries. Salmon berry, elderberry, blueberry. No blueberry. Blackberry, raspberry, of course. Anyway, some things to consider, like keeping some separation between all of the berries, maybe planting something in between, why I shouldn't grow corn in my garden. They take up a lot of the nutrients out of the soil. Putting a blackberry in their own kind of separated space as well, because it's just invasive and does all sorts of things. Follow-up challenge, if you've had a chance to jot down your garden design, send it to me! I'll drop something in the description so that you can send that over to me. Though I'm no pro, but I'd be happy to take a look. That'd be fun. I'm in that kind of headspace right now, so drop me a link. And let's go get these puppies planted.
Take me outside, sit in the green garden. Nobody out there, but it's okay now. Bathe in the sunlight, don't mind if rain falls. Take me outside, sit in the green garden.
All right, so starting over here, we have oregano. Is that oregano? Yeah. And then we have our apple tree. Next up, sage, followed by the next apple. And then thyme, followed by the final apple. We have these two Asian pears we're gonna put over there. Some sage, some comfrey. So we got a start going. And now we're plotting the remainder of the goodies. So we're gonna pull them out of the pots, get them in the ground. Depending on what you choose, each one should be probably positioned a little differently depending on where the light is. So a little Googling should tell you exactly what each would prefer. How much space it needs, how much water it needs, how much sun it needs, how much love it needs.
In order to plant the pear trees, we gotta finish with this ivy.
Gotta get it out of there. We can do that. Would you like to plant a... It's our last tomato, tomato San Maranzo. So first thing, you just wanna dig through all of the layers, down through the cardboard. So here's that bottom layer of cardboard. We just wanna chisel out a nice little hole for it right here. Perfect. We take this puppy, we're gonna put this label right over here, put in some of that fresh topsoil in there, and we'll take this dude out of its pot, and we'll just kind of break him loose a little bit so that he can breathe, his roots can go and grow, and flourish and flow, and then we plant right there. And then we just hug them good and tight with some of that fresh soil. Just like that. And then we put some of this hay on top to keep the moisture in the soil better. And that's that. Simple. All right, what's next? Kale. Let's get that in the ground. Yo. Look how dope this pepper looks.
Pope.
Yeah. That's a Pope plant right there.
Just poping out.
Pope.
Shoot, sun's gone. Got a double time.
Yo. We have a garden.
So I probably waited a little too long to do this video because, or this recap follow-up, because everything's kind of overgrown and dead. It's just winter's coming, but it was good. It served me well. Some key things that I would have done differently is to space things out a little more and not be so uniform, be a little more kind of organic with throwing around seed and whatnot. Just kind of did like a row of lettuce, a row of basil, another row of basil, a row of kale, another row of kale, a row of cauliflower. And so it got pretty just static. I kind of like when you can walk in between everything and stuff's a little more scattered around. So there's this other technique that I think I'm gonna try next season where you just take kind of all the seeds that you want and you just throw them. You just throw them in your garden and see what survives. Survival of the fittest. Ideally, the best genes win and you get the best yield. So I'm gonna try that out. And this just kind of will turn into a bit of a cover crop. It'll all just kind of die, decompose, and make the soil nice and delicious. And that's what's going on over here too. It's about four different seeds of clove, of barley, a couple other things that are just gonna grow up and then just chop it down. And it's got a lot of nitrogen in it, so that'll get in the soil. Other than that, loving the garden. It's good. Probably one of my favorite things to do in the morning. Got my cup of coffee, do my little Tai Chi sesh. Come, check out the garden, say hi to the goods, give them a little love. It's good stuff. So that was a trial number one for the garden. Not too bad, though. As you can see, I live in Portland, where it is lush and wet and the soil is fertile, so it's really hard to mess up. I've got a good canvas I'm working with here. So I hope you learned a few things, enjoyed it, inspired you to maybe get your hands in some soil, grow something, a little plant in your house, garden outside, whatever it may be. Go get it. It's worth it. It's fun. A lot to learn. So I'll be checking in round two. Peace.